Good morning.
Good
morning. How's everyone doing?
Great.
Peachy? Oh, that's good. I like that. Peachy. Are the decorations nice? How many love Christmas? I love Christmas. It's a great time. I tell you, I'm so pleased. I love the lights and everything. I tell you, someone said, you know, that looks like the Grinch green on the cross there. So I don't know if it's the Grinch that stole Christmas cross, but it's pretty cool though. I like it. How many like it? I think it's pretty neat and the little trees and everything's so cool. But anyways, God is good. If you're a Bibles, please turn with me, if you would, to Philippians chapter 4, verse 14. And this is the last message in Philippians. And it's amazing. I always love, like John Corson said, when he first taught the Bible, the whole Bible, it took him, 7 years. And then he said the second time he taught through the Bible, it took him 14 years. And then he said the third time, which is now, he's on 18 years. How many know, the more you study the Bible, the more you see how little you know. You know, I could go through this book when I first got saved or first started the ministry. I could do this book in probably 3 teachings. But how many know there's a lot of stuff in here. And today we're going to see something that I think is very important for the church. And I want you to know this. I'll first give you the title. It's called, Who Does God Supply? Now, how many believe that you need to be supplied in this day and age? How many know you need to be blessed and supplied by God? How many want God to provide for you, right? So we need to know what we need to do that releases God to bless us. Because there are things that bless God and there are things that grieve God, as Mariah said. And we need to make sure that we're doing things that bless the Lord, that release Him and His Word to move in our lives. Amen? And so we're going to see that today. So we're going to see who does God supply or who does God provide for. Verse 14 of Philippians 4. Nevertheless, you have done well that you share in my distress. Paul has just been speaking the last couple of verses before this about his ability to be content in any situation. Remember that Paul is in what? He's in a prison right now. He is chained to a guard 6 hours a day, always a new guard, and he's chained to this guard. And yet he says, I have been found. Think about it. He says, I'm content in all things. I have everything in Christ. And yet he's in jail. Isn't that amazing? How many would like to be able to live like that? Not in jail maybe, but live to where you are always content, no matter where you are. Your happiness, your joy is not based on your circumstances. But I want to tell you, my joy is a lot of times, sadly, amen? How many were reading the terrorist attack stuff? Anyone read that? Well, I did the very thing I said to not do. Is Dwayne right there? Yeah. Remember I said, Dwayne always quotes me on where, make sure you study the good news before you read the bad news, right? I always say, don't first thing, look at the news. Well, I did what I said not to do. Imagine that. And I just listened to the news pretty much Friday night. And then I listened to the news Saturday morning. And guess what? I was cranky. Imagine. But I'm kind of happy. Can I just say this? And I hope you guys are all cool. You know, I love how there's certain things we can say in the foyer, but we can't say to each other publicly. But I want to tell you, how many are glad that our president is finally having to admit that there's terrorism in America? Amen? Amen. That we have to say there's a problem, and we can't say, oh, it's just acts against humanity. Yeah, that's it. I heard a guy from Israel. I love people from Israel. Do you love the Jewish people? This guy from Israel, who's one of the guys on Fox News about he helps the first responders, he said this, the first thing we need to do is, one, we need to call it what it is, radical Islamic terrorism. Second thing, he said, is we have 100 mosques, he said, we interviewed. 100 mosques, and 80 of those mosques in America, there's over more than 100, but he says 100 mosques, and 80 of them are preaching jihad or have literature on jihad. And he said, we're a country that should be about freedom of religion unless your religion promotes what? Death. Amen? And he says, we need to stop that. And I mean, I go, I want these Israelis to be running for government. You know, I just love it. And then he said, third, he said, just like Netanyahu, the only way you stop a wrong ideology is by defeating the people who are promoting it. But guess what? We live in a PC day where, well, you know, how many know? I want to tell you this, guys. Do you realize that when we broke away from England, do you know who the number one people that they wanted to go against, that they wanted to come against, was the pastors? They called them the Black Robe Regiment. They were the ones who were saying, guys, we need to break away. We need to stand against this tyranny. We need to have freedom of religion. How many know we need pastors like that again? Amen? And I pray that we don't just like Donald Trump with the funky hair, right? That we like pastors that speak the same truth too. Amen? Because sometimes I think it's weird. We kind of go, oh, pastor, no, don't say that. But we go, oh, Donald Trump, yeah! Right? But we need pastors that speak the truth in love too. That say, that call wrong, wrong, and right, right. Amen? We are not to be, let me just say this. I want to say this. I heard John Corson on a study for this. He said two things, and I just want to say this. This is free. And people say I get in trouble when I say free, but here it is. He said there's two things that are very hard for a pastor to talk about. One is other ministries or things of government that are not right. Because what do people say? Oh, you shouldn't say, never should be heard a disparaging word. Home on the range. Right? That somehow as a pastor you should never say anything bad. But I love what John Corson said. I wish I was John Corson. He says, if all I do is feed you as sheep, just feed you the word, then I'm fattening you up. I'm just making you a fat sheep ready for the kill, ready to be devoured by the wolf. How many know there's wolves out there? And there's wolves even in the pulpits. And we need to warn people. And I want to tell you, I just heard something the other day that I'm not ready to say yet because I haven't had it confirmed, but I've heard it from a couple people. But there's a big church in town that is now doing same-sex marriages. And some of you went to that church, if that gives you an idea. I mean, how many know that is a concern? And we need to say, whoa, 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 whoa. We can't say, hey, look, kumbaya, my Lord, kumbaya. No, we can't say that. We have to say, no, that is wrong. That goes against the word of God. Amen. We love the sinner, but we hate the sin. And we have to be, you have to be open to that. The second thing he says, the other thing that's hard is to talk about giving. Now, if some of you read the text, that's what we're talking about. So close your ears and shut your hearts to what I'm going to say. Okay, but he says giving because what do people say? Oh, all that, what is it saying? All those churches want is what? Your love, right? No, your money. But hear this. God talks a lot about money, doesn't he? Because Jesus said, where your treasure is, there will be your heart also. What you spend money on is what you love. So if all your money is being spent on your house and pleasures, then guess who you love? What did God say in the last days? Men will be lovers of pleasure rather than what? Lovers of God. And I pray that you and I want to turn around and be lovers of God more than love. Not that we don't ever love pleasure, right? We love vacations. We love having some nice things. But guess what? We should make sure we're not doing those things. I love, someone joked the other day and said, hey, I bought a new thing with my tie, so it's all good. So it's going to be a little rough this next couple months, but I bought something with your tie. You know what I mean? How many old people do that? It's Christmas time. Sorry, God. I got to buy my kids a new bike. You know, that's not right. That's not right. But I know you guys love me, and I can say that to you, right? Amen. All right, let's get going here. I see some faces. This is going to be a good one. But Paul is talking about his ability to be content in any situation. Here's the verse 12 of Philippians. He says this, I know how to live on almost nothing or with everything. Remember, he was a Pharisee. He was part of the Sanhedrin, so he's a part of the Supreme Court, so he had lots of money. Usually those guys are wealthy. I have learned the secret of living in every situation, whether it is with a full stomach or an empty stomach, with plenty or little. Verse 13, for I can do, or another way of saying it is I can endure all things or everything through Christ who gives me strength. Isn't that amazing? We always think of it as I can do all things, like I am super Christian, but really it's saying we can endure. How many need the strength to endure? How many know those people that just got attacked in their families? Can you imagine having that Christmas, your loved one was just killed? Can you imagine being one of the 17 that was wounded? How many know they need to hear this verse? I can endure all things through Christ who gives me strength. You need to pray for them that they find Christ if they don't know him in this pain. Now, Paul didn't want to give the impression here to the Philippians that they had somehow done something wrong in, because he's saying that verse means, verse 14 means they supply, they were supporting him financially by giving him a gift for his ministry. He's saying, I don't want you to think you did something wrong, but here was the real sense in which the financial giving of the Philippians, hear this, what Paul is basically saying here, it was better for them that they gave the gift than it was for Paul to receive the gift. Verse 14 again, he says in the middle, you have done well. Isn't that amazing? You have done well in giving this gift to me, Paul's saying. Paul shows us here that godly giving actually does more good, as I said, for the giver than it does for the one who receives the gifts. Now hear this. I want you to really hear this. This is Jesus talking in Acts 20:35. You might want to write it down if you're a note taker. Acts 20:35. Jesus said, it's more blessed to give than to receive. How many know the church would be a lot different if we really believed that verse? Amen? We think it's more blessed to give. Give me, give me, give me, give me. But Jesus said, you are more blessed when you're a giver than a taker. How many know America needs to know that today? They say there's two kinds of people in America, givers and takers. And how many know there's a lot more takers than givers nowadays? But what would happen if we really believe what Jesus said? And that it's more blessed to give. It's we work to be a blessing to others. We want to be a giver to God and His work and to people who really need help. And that we'll be more blessed by giving than taking. But we have believed the lie of this world and covetousness and greed that is more blessed. Give me, what does it say? He who dies with the most toys wins. How many know what the guy from, I always forget his name, Eric, I always get it mixed up. Who's the guy who got killed by the Indians, the Aka Indians? He said, he is no fool to give up what he cannot keep to gain what he cannot lose. Who is that? Who is the guy? Jim Elliot. But do you hear that? He is no fool to give up what he cannot keep. You cannot keep your wealth. There's no hurt. There's no motorhome or there's no U-Haul behind a hearse, right? But you can send it on ahead. Amen? You can send it on ahead. Well, let's pray because I think I need some prayer here because I can see some of you. Father, thank you so much. And I thank you that everyone here loves your word. Amen? And that as long as it's you, we embrace it. And I pray right now, you'll bind every demonic spirit that will make people close their hearts and close their ears and close their minds and say, whoa, he's talking about giving, I can't listen. But I pray that they would say, Lord, I want to hear the truth. I want to hear what you say about giving. I want to hear how to be secure and that how I can be supported by you. How I can trust in this crazy economy, in these crazy times that, Lord, you've got my back financially. And so, Lord, I pray, I know everyone here wants financial security. I know everyone here wants to know that you are going to provide, that you are Jehovah Jireh. But, Lord, show us today that there are some conditions for us to have that confidence. There are some biblical conditions that need to be met for us to have that security, that we can be blessed as a people, that we can be blessed as a church, that we can be blessed again as a nation. And so, Lord, my prayer is that we would not just have revival spiritually, but as Donald Trump says, I would like to see America become great again. And, Lord, the way what made this country great was not Benjamin Franklin, was not John Quincy Adams, but was you, Lord. You, following your godly principles, following your word. That's what made America great. Amen? And so, Lord, we need to turn back, Lord. We repent and we say, Lord, today, help us not just to be hearers of the word. Help us not just to know the word and say, oh, yeah, I know it. But, Lord, let us wrestle with your word to where then it becomes us. We say, I can't just be a hearer of this word anymore, but I need to be an effectual doer. What I know is not enough. I need to do what I know. Amen? And so, God, help us, Lord. Help me. Help us. To be those effectual doers. Hear that, effectual, to have effect, to have good effect. That means we have to live it. So God, forgive me. Forgive us when I think that knowing it is the same as living it. And show us humbly, Lord, that it is not. I must, as you said, why do you call me Lord, Lord, but do not do what I say? God, I'm so sorry that you can say that in so many areas of my life. But Lord, I want to be obedient. I want to be someone who says, Lord, I'm not obeying it yet, but by your grace and strength today, I'll obey it more than I ever have. Bless your people with obedience. Let this be a church that honors you in obedience because we love you. Not to earn your love, not to just earn your love or favor, but Lord, we do it because we have your favor, because you're so good. And we say, Lord, we want to do what's right because, Lord, what it What a man sows, he reaps. If we sow against you, we're going to reap corruption. But if we sow to you in your spirit and your word, we will reap life. We reap eternal life and reap benefits and life more abundantly. So God, bless us. Speak to us, I pray, in Jesus' most powerful name. And everyone agreed, said,
Amen.
Verse 15 of Philippians. I want to read this in the New Living because I think the New Living says it a little clearer. So I'm reading the New Living. So if you go, what happened? That's what happened. As you know, you Philippians were the only ones who gave me financial help. Now think about that. Out of all the churches he started, I don't know how many right now off the top of my head, but he started a lot. Only the Philippians helped him. Isn't that sad? So giving's a struggle even back then. So don't think you're the only bad people. Don't say, well, hey, they were bad, so continue. No, it's a struggle because why? Our flesh loves our money. It's my cash. How many know it's, what does the Bible say? Every good gift comes from the Lord. Guess whose cash is your cash? It's God's cash. Aren't you glad he only asked for 10% instead of the whole 100? So you can't live like that. So he says, but he says, they were the only ones who gave him financial help. When I first brought you the good news and then traveled on to Macedonia, no other church did this. How sad. Here he started the church, shared the gospel with them and led them to Christ, and they didn't share it. No other church did it. Verse 16, even when I was in Thessalonica, you sent help more than once. How many know those Philippians that did that and sacrificed, and they weren't a rich church? How many know they're thankful in heaven that they gave to Paul, they gave to God, and gave to the work of the ministry? I love what J. Vernon McGee said. How many would love to have Paul as your missionary? Be pretty cool, right? You know your money's going to a good place. He says, I was reading this year in the one-year Bible, and this is what the one-year Bible said this week. It says this, 1 John 3:17. This is a verse that's always convicted me. It says, if someone has enough money to live well and sees a brother or sister in need but shows no compassion, how can God's love be in that person? Convicting, isn't it? Now, here's my question for us, the church. As I've said many times, a lot of people love to give to the poor. And they love to give the poor. And how many know that's good, right? It's good to give the poor. God cares about the poor. But hear this. When they're asked why they give to the poor, they don't go because God tells me to. A lot of times they say, I give to the poor because it makes me what? Feel good. But I want to say this to you lovingly. I'm very conflicted about giving to the people in the corner, because if you spend any time with those people, and I have, you smell some things on their breath. You see some things on their skin from doing crack or from doing, crystal meth. You know that in a way you're funding the very thing that's killing them. And how many know it might make you feel good to throw a 20 at them, but how many know it's really, you're sort of throwing a bullet at them. And what you should probably do is buy them a sandwich. Amen? Give them some food. Don't throw them money, because, you know, I've done that. I've given food and they go, I want money! And I go, well, I know what you're going to do with your money. Isn't that amazing? Don't look a gift horse in the mouth. I had him get mad at me. I remember one time I gave this guy a sandwich. Next thing I know, I came back about a half hour later. He's trying to sell a sandwich. $5. This is a great sandwich, dude. Seriously. So here's my question. We say it makes me feel good. Now here's the question. Why doesn't giving to God's church and his work make us feel good? How many know it's sad that now the church is almost looked upon with contempt? Now hear me, has there been some abuses? Oh, yes, there has. But I love what Pastor John Corson said. He said, you should tithe because God says to tithe. But hear this, if you can't respect this church to tithe, you say, well, Craig's too fat, he's eating all the money, whatever, then you need to go to a church where you can respect the pastor and leadership, to where you are comfortable tithing. Amen? Because how many know, every church you go to, you can find some reason to justify not giving, right? And usually it's because we're just being selfish. It's not because we're really worried about the money. It's because a lot of times we want to use that money for something else. I'll never forget this guy says, Craig, I don't want to give money to this church because I don't think you're using it well. And I go, well, what are you based on? I don't know, I just feel it. But that person just bought a second house, and because they bought a second house, they had used their tithe money to buy that house, and they couldn't afford to tithe anymore. How many know our flesh can justify anything? Don't rob, don't spend so much that you rob God. Amen? Budget. Take that out like you do your mortgage payment. Do you ever say to your mortgage company, hey, I'm sorry, I bought my kids a ton of great gifts this year, so I'm only going to be able to pay half. Would you ever think of doing that? Hello? Would you? Because what would they say? That's great, but you're not going to have Christmas in your house. I want to say this. If we care about the poor on the corner, then we should care about the church. We should care that the church, our church is in still $25,000 short of its budget. And hear this, guys. We didn't raise our budget for 10, almost 11 years. We just cut things. We kept the same budget. We just kept cutting and cutting and cutting. How many know everything else is going up, right? Push Ridge, the Christian school, every year, $1,000. Every year, $1,000. Every year, $1,000. I haven't had a raise in 11 years. Okay? But hear this. We only raised our budget $2,500 in 11 years, and that's because we moved to a building that we have more money. But hear this. Should we not care about the house of God? Amen. Now, you might say, oh, flah, 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 flah. Well, let's hear what God says. Haggai, verse chapter 1, verse 6. If you can turn there quick. If not, I'll read it to you. Write it down. Haggai chapter 1, verse 6. And this, hear this for us as Americans. Hear this for us of why we struggle. And I know some of you are not happy here, but hear this. I don't care about your happiness. I care about you being right with God. Amen? I don't care about you going, right? Do you get your kid every, when he screams in the aisle, when your kid goes, I want that. Do you go, oh, well, there you go, honey. This is one of those messages that disciplines us, but I believe if we obey it, it will change our life for the good. You'll be happy you obeyed God, not Craig, but God. Hear this. You have planted much, but harvest little. Sound like America? You eat, but are not satisfied. You drink, but are still thirsty. You put on clothes, but cannot keep warm. Hear this. You'll love this one. Your wages disappear. Ever feel that way? Man, what happened? Your wages disappear as though you were putting them in pockets filled with holes. Ever feel that way? Verse 7, this is what the Lord of Heaven's army says. Look at what's happening to you. Verse 8, now go up into the hills and bring down timber and rebuild my house. Now hear that. None of you are going to bring a bunch of wood and say, here you go, Pastor Craig. But how many know, what does that mean? Provision. Bring provision. How many know, we still have things to do in this house. We still have a fellowship hall we need to build. We still have a kids area that we want to build. We still have things we want to do. And how many know? If we met budget, we'd be able to do it without taking even a special offering. Because and some of you are going to go, But we have savings in our budget. Because guess what? Very few of you give a special offering. So we put saved, right? You know, the church, you remember that? We said tithe was for the church. That was to run it. Offering was over and above. We said, hey, we're going to build a new wing. We got we need $15,000. Let's raise it. You guys would go, I barely tithe. But you know, it's supposed to be what? Tithe is your mortgage payment, and over and above is your offering. Remember what I said? The average Jew gave 23 to 28% of his income. Some of you are just saying, some of you are going, I just want to tithe after 50 years. I love this. Someone said to me, Craig, I'm trying to up my tithe. How many of there's no upping your tithe? You either tithe or you don't tithe. Tithe is what? 10%, right? 10% of your gross income. It's either you're doing it or you're not doing it. Now, hear this. You pay your tithe. Now you can say, I want to up my offering, which is over and above, right? But you don't up your tithe, right? That's to say, I'm upping my mortgage. No, you're either paying your mortgage or you're not. Does that make sense? Can I get some love out there? A little smiling here. I know it's hitting home. Some of you, I hate him. I really hate him. Right? I don't get to talk on this much. It's not in the text much. So I got to work this. Okay? Here it is. This is what the Lord's of Heaven, verse 7. This is what the Lord of Heaven's army says. Look at what's happening to you. How many don't like what's happening to America? Amen. So hear this. Verse 8, now go up into the hills, bring down timber, and rebuild my house. So God kind of cares about his church, does he not? Then he didn't say about the poor first, he says his house. I will take pleasure in it and be what? Honored, says the Lord. Verse 9, you hope for rich harvest, but they were poor. How many hope that your business does well? How many hope that your company does well? Well, here, if you see a little struggle, here's maybe the answer. Here it is. You hope for rich harvest, but they were poor. And when you brought your harvest home, hear this, you're going to love this. Who blew it away? God says, I blew it away. Not the devil, not the IRS, I blew it away. Because, why? Because my house, my church, lies in ruins, says the Lord of Heaven's army. While all of you are busy building your own fine houses, none of us do that, right? Verse 10, it's because of you that the heavens withhold the dew and the earth produces no crops. Do you know what made America great? It wasn't just Jesus. It was obeying Jesus. Do you realize, I could show you, I'm not going to waste the time, but if you ever want to ask, I'll show you, but all the great companies, I think I've told you, Colgate, tithe. Ivory Soap, tithe. JCPenney, tithe. Welch's, tithe. Kerr Jars, canning jars, tithe. All these great companies, they all started poor, but they honored God with their giving, and they became rich. How many know this? If you can't tithe now when you're poor, you're not going to tithe when you're rich. I never forget. Anyone heard of David Meal, George Meal? Built La Paloma. Ever heard of La Paloma? Built the little place called Dove Mountain, right? Well, he didn't build. His brother did, but he would have built it. But George Meal said this. It was very hard for me to tithe on $100,000. But I'll tell you, when I made my first million, it was really hard to write a check for $100,000. So I want to tell you this. Young people, start tithing now to where it's in your heart, to where you don't say, someday when I'm 150 years old, I think I'm going to tithe. Because I'm going to tell you guys, you're missing out an immense blessing by honoring God with your wealth. How many could raise their hand and say that they believe that with all their heart? And don't if you don't tithe, don't raise your hand. But how many can say you've seen it? There you go. Look, at over half our church. Now, some of you are raising your hands and don't tithe. You're liars. But anyway, but those you have, you know the blessing that comes. You know that God can do more with your 90 than you can do with the full 100. And hear this, guys. I say this because I believe it. Think of me. What pastor says this? Because I know you love it. You're like, give me more. Please, more. Tell me more about giving. I can see it in your faces. But guess what? I love you, right? And just as a coach says, come on, one more set, one more! I'm saying, come on, guys, trust God with your wealth. And you go, no! No! And then you wonder, why is my... You know? And you go, Craig, can I have some money from the church? No! Because we don't have any. You know what I mean? It's like, I love you. We need to reach out to missions. And I said to you, when we make our budget, we'll give to missions. Right? I'm not Obama. I don't give money we don't have. But hear this. Here's the blessing that comes when we obey God. Here's the blessing. You want to hear the opposite? We heard the bad news. I hear the good news. Malachi 3:12. Hear this. Hear this. This is what we want for America, is it not? Then for those who tithe, those who give offerings, because God said you robbed me in tithes and offerings, here's what he says. Then all, when you do this, when you finally obey, then all the nations will call you blessed. How many like people to call America blessed again? Said the great Satan. Do you know the Bible says if a man's ways are pleasing the Lord, he'll make even his enemies to live at peace with him? How many like to have some enemies live at peace with us? How many like to have ISIS stop blowing up? How many know? Do you know? I mean, churches are going to be next. You know that, right? How many would like that to not happen here, right? You know, now we're one of those, I better not say, but anyways, we're like a cop bar. You know, ever seen someone try to rob a cop bar? We are not a kumbaya church, you know what I mean? We're not one like that church, you know, where the guy, hey, come right this way. We're going to be like, hey, wrong church, sorry. We'll pray for you, you know, but, you know, no. But anyways, do you know, during the start of our country, do you know there's pastors? There's one pastor who used to preach because he was the Black Robe Regiment. He used to preach with two pistols on his pulpit. Can you imagine? We don't even think a pastor should defend himself. There's pastors that had so much grit, they put their guns on their pulpit. I would like to institute that again. Wouldn't it be little gunslingers right here? Hey, how you doing? What's going on? You better tithe. But here it is, Malachi 3:12. All the nations will call you blessed, for your land will be such a delight, says the Lord of heaven's armies. That's what God says if you obey him. And isn't it funny? We go, Lord, bless America. Lord, bless America. And God says, well, why don't you obey my word? Well, no. Lord, bless America. And God says, here's how I do it. This is what releases me to bless America. Amen? Remember what he said to Jeremiah when he talked about the people repenting? He says, remember the old ways. What made America great? The old ways where people gave and they trusted God with their wealth. And God says what? He honors those who honor him.
Amen.
But we say, no, bless me first, God, then I'll give. How many know God says, no, trust me first, then I will bless you. Right? Peter, the water didn't get hard before Peter stepped out on it. How many know? It was like, splashy, splashy, hard, huh? Right? It wasn't like, boom, became cement. And he goes, oh, that's no big deal. It was, as soon as he touched, I believe it became hard. Even though it seems to not be popular, like Haggai, to care about the local church, God seems to care very much about his church. Amen? And I want to tell you this, hear this. This is my heart. You might not think a lot about me, but hear this. I want to bring honor back to the church of Jesus Christ. I want to bring honor back to the pulpit of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And I'm sorry if you hear a little anger in me once in a while, because I am very disappointed in the church, the pulpits of most of the churches in our country. And I want to tell you that Jesus says he's coming back for a church without spot or wrinkle, without outward sin and without inward sin. And how many know we have a lot of sin in the church, even our church, and even in our leadership, and we need to say, I told the leadership, it says in 2 Corinthians 2:10, it says, once your obedience is complete, I require the obedience of others. I can't demand more from you than I demand from myself and God. So pray for us. Pray for that I will be a man of integrity. I tell you, I'm not saying I got hidden sin. I'm just saying there's areas like this that I don't obey, and God's saying, you have to if you're going to ask my people to obey. How many love that Jesus said, follow me? How many of Jesus said, as I have loved you, love? Everything Jesus asked us to do, he did and more.
Amen.
Amen? He wasn't one of those leaders. Do as I say, not as I do, or else I'll smack you. Verse 17. I didn't say this because I want a gift from you. It sounds like you do, Pastor Greg. But I don't want a gift from you. Rather, I want you to receive, hear this, a reward for your kindness. Isn't it funny? People say, oh, I don't give to get a reward. Well, Paul says he thought that he wanted them to have a reward. And I mean, if God says to Paul, we should say, I would like a reward, right? Right? We all want a 401k. We all want to be provided for, right? God's saying through Paul, hey, your kindness is going to be rewarded. And here it is. Now, what's the reward for their kindness? Or what is the fruit of their kindness? Giving to the Lord and his church. Hear this. I love this, that Paul was thanking the Philippians for their financial gift that they sent, not because he desired a gift, but here is, he said, I desire a reward, or if the fruit might be accredited to your account. Hear this, it's really good. People say, oh, you know, I don't want to know what I give. You know, people give cash. How many know this? Hear this, guys. Do you know in the Old Testament they used to do wave offerings? You know what I mean? They used to do this. And it wasn't to say, hey, look what I'm giving. It was just they were happy to give to the Lord. Don't fall into that trap. Well, I don't want my right hand to know. That was saying that if you brag giving to the poor, like if I go, I'm helping Ted, who's really poor in our church. I'm giving him $25. Aren't I great? That's what he's saying. But how many know you should know? How many know? How can you tithe if you don't know what, you don't figure it out in math? But hear this. If you're not sure, read this on your own. Read Ezra chapter 2 today. And Ezra chapter 2, look at how it goes through a list methodically of all that people gave. It's almost like God is keeping record. And you go, I don't know about that. Yes, all the utensils, all that was given. But hear this. Don't you remember Jesus, your Lord and Savior, looking at the woman giving her mite? And it says he marveled over it. He was like, wow, look at that. Now what would we say? Hey, whoa. Don't give out of your need. Jesus didn't stop her, did he? Why? Because he believed you can't outgive the Father. You give in love for the Father, even if that's your money for your meal that day. You give in love for the Father. He knew the Father will take care of that little widow. And we either believe that or we don't. Because why wouldn't Jesus, as a loving Savior, say, don't do that. No. And yet we have more than we need most of the time. But we say, I want to put a new bathroom in. I want to do this. I want to do that. And I'm sorry, God. And then you know what God says lovingly? I'm sorry, I can't bless a people and a nation that does that. You're loving me, aren't you? Now, God has a very interesting bookkeeping. You know, he keeps an account, but here is bookkeeping system. In God's bookkeeping system, the investments that you make into the kingdom of God will, hear this, bring great reward or fruit to your heavenly account. How many want to be rich in your heavenly account? As I said, you can't take it with you, but you can send it on ahead. And isn't it amazing? We're all worried about our stocks, our 401ks. Oh, I don't have any. But, you know, I worry about not having any. Oh, but that's for a vapor. That's for a little puff of steam, this life is. But we don't care about a zillion years. How many should want to have a good 401k in heaven? And some of you got some pretty sad 401ks in heaven. Hello? They'll bring a great reward of fruit to the heavenly account. I believe your financial investment to the kingdom of God will be part of the crowns. This is my opinion, that they will lay at God's feet. This will be part of the crowns. It will be. It's just like your giving statement at the end of the year. When you see your giving statement, you go, wow, praise the Lord. Look what I was able to give. You don't brag to yourself. But you go, thank God, right? I do. But some of you look at your giving statement and go, ooh, better hide that. How many know that those who sacrifice will be rewarded and honored in heaven? That's what Paul's saying. Now, I don't know exactly how it's going to be, but how many know there's going to be, as I love what J. Vernon McGee, there's going to be some very wealthy people in heaven. And I don't think we should say the lie anymore. Well, I'll just be happy to be a dishwasher and as long as I'm in heaven. Well, if you're not happy being a dishwasher here, why would you be happy being a dishwasher for a gazillion years? Amen? Amen? Matthew 6:19, Jesus said this, do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy, where thieves break in and steal, verse 20, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust destroy, where your stock market doesn't crash, amen? Rust destroys, where the thieves do not break in and steal, right? All the people on the Wall Street. Verse 21, for where your treasure is, there will be your heart also. Do you hear that? Jesus saying, how you know you love God, look at your checkbook. Look at it. Because I love what I think it was Spurgeon who said, a man can brag about how much he loves God, but he said, let me look at his checkbook where he spends his money, and that will tell me where he really is, his love is. Amen? If we believe this is everything, if we believe this is the hope of America, we would give to the churches and causes that support the true gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen? We would not sit back and go, oh, I'm going to just kind of enjoy my life because this is such a miserable place. I'm going to get my big screen TV, do all these things because I just want to be miserable. Do you hear this? I just want to be fat, dumb, and happy. How many know, guys, I want to tell you this. I am dumb enough to believe that there can be an awakening again in America. Amen? But it's going to take some finance. It's going to take some commitment from the people of God. It's not just going to be me doing it. It's going to be what? Us doing it. God's accounts to the person, or credits to the person, the one who supports their church with the tithe, the one who also gives the reward. He gives reward to the person who gives an offering, which, hear this, guys, remember, tithe is for the church you go to. And after this message, maybe you're going to go to another church, but tithe there. Tithe is where you go to church. That's your mortgage payment. Amen? 10% of your gross income. An offering over and above. A lot of you split your tithe and give to Crisis Pregnancy Center or give to, now it's Hands of Hope, or give to Gospel Rescue. How many know the tithe goes to church, period, and then offering is over and above. You give to the poor. You give to World Vision. That's your offering over and above. Do you ever wonder that when they say, we want to receive your tithes and offerings? I used to go, what is it? That's what it is. But a lot of us say, well, I'm not giving more than 10%, so I'll give 5% to the church and 5% to the thing. And you wonder why you're not blessed, because as I had a sermon that says, robbing while giving. Because it's not the way God. Remember when Cain brought his offering of vegetables? God said, if you bring the right offering, it'd be happy. But guess what? Sin's crouching at the door. Don't you bring what you think is right, it isn't going to be accepted. You bring what I say, it'll be accepted. How many want to do it God's way? Amen. So that's why I tell you this. Because I know there's a ton of pastors out there talking about this, right? Yeah, whatever. Anyway, the ones that are saying, sow your seed faith gift so I can have a new Learjet. How many know I don't want to? I know I'm dressing pretty fancy nowadays. Gucci shirts, right? You know, give me a break. Anyway, here's the spiritual fruit. Where is it? And here it is. This is. Hear this. The spiritual fruit, so your offering goes to the missionary, goes to World Vision, goes to Crisis Pregnancy Center, goes to Gospel Rescue Mission. And hear this. This is the second promise of fruit or reward. Hear this. Meaning the spiritual fruit, meaning also the souls that are being saved by the pastor or missionary or ministry that you support financially. The fruit, hear this, that comes from their ministry is accredited to your heavenly account. That means the people, hear this, how the people that are saved through that ministry is who's accredited to your account. How many love that? That's why you want to invest in the ministry that's preaching the word, right? Because hear this, I want to say this real quick. Every time I get here, people say I get in trouble, but here it is. People go, Craig,
why does somebody, if this church is preaching the word of God, why does so many people leave? Why?
And what is that? It's a kick to my gut, right?
You're a loser.
You want to know what Jesus, I said, Jesus, how do I answer this? Because it hurts. You know what Jesus said to me? Light is coming to the world, Jesus. But men love the darkness. Because their deeds were evil. Pretty good answer? People can say whatever reason they leave this church, and I'm sorry, this is going to make some of you mad, but people leave this church because there's usually an issue that they didn't want to deal with in Christ. Amen? And they can spin it, Craig's fat, he's ugly, he's stupid. Okay, we got that. But what is the reason you left? And most people leave because they didn't want to submit to God in an area. And if you have a problem with that, tell me, or leave quietly, but tell me, because I'm telling you, I can, everything you've heard, I can say why. And I'm not saying because I can spin it, it's the truth. And hear this, I will work with anybody who wants to be worked with, but if someone says, this is who I am and I'm not changing, then there's plenty of churches that will help, that'll help you along in your carnality. But I'm not going to be one of them. Because I believe I'm going to give an account, and I'd rather be hard on you here when you can change than love you all the way to maybe hearing, depart from me, I never knew you. How many know the Bible says you can be angry and sin not? And I am angry. As you can hear it? I am angry. But I don't want to sin. Paul says, how can they preach in Romans full time except they be... how can they hear unless a preacher is sent? He says, how can they preach full time except they be financially supported or sent? So those who send financial help share equally in the fruit of the ministry of those who go. And hear this too. I just want to say this for this too. Remember our church, our goal, the vision that God's given us. What's the vision of God? People say, what's the reason, purpose for the church is to what? Go and make disciples. Notice he didn't say, go and make a mega church, did he? He said, go and make disciples. And what's the key of a disciple? And teach them to what? Know the word. No, teach them to obey everything I command. How many of that separates the men from the boys? Obey. So you get, see what I mean? I would love to have a bigger church, trust me. But I want a church filled with people who want to obey God. Amen. And I want to tell you, the Bible says, Paul says to Timothy, preach Christ in and out of season. And guess what? We're living in a time where it isn't seasonable. People don't want the truth. They want their truth. They want truth according to their will. And guess what? You notice I'm not trying to do that. Because some of you right now are going, I willed that you would say something else than this. Right? But what are they going to get? It doesn't say they're not going to endure doctrine or teaching. They're not going to endure sound doctrine. They're going to get teachers that will tell them, like, remember Clinton? What's the poll saying? What should I say? I'm not doing that. I have one master, and that's Jesus Christ. And I say, in love what he says. And maybe that love seems painful right now, but I am saying what I believe with all my heart is him. Amen? And here's another promise as you give to the Lord's house and his work. He promises you'll be blessed so that you can become a continued blessing to others. How many like to be blessed to be a blessing? See, TBN tells you, be blessed, sow your seed, faith, gifts, so you can be blessed for self. I don't need help with self. You know, I know why I'm not rich, because I would flesh out. Anyone else could say that? But God's saying his desire to bless you and I, and to bless people like Colgate and all these great men that tithe, was so that they could what? Be a blessing. Do you know a lot of those guys did reverse tithe? A lot of those guys were so blessed by God, they would take 10% of their wealth and they would give the 90 to the church. How many love to be able to do that? And isn't it weird? And they actually lived where they said, all I need is this much, God. Could you imagine being a multi-billionaire like Bill Gates and say, I only need $100,000 a year? Isn't it amazing? The more we make, the more we spend. When do we need? We can say, this is enough right here. That's all I need. Everything else to God. But we say, no. I've always needed a $25 million house. Remember, honey? I always said that. 2 Corinthians 9:10 says this, for God is the one who provides seed for the farmer and then bread to eat. In the same way, he will provide the increase. Hear that, increase. He will provide the increase, your resources, and produce a great harvest of generosity in you. Verse 11, yes, you will be enriched in every way. Why? So you can be selfish and greedy and covetous? No. So that you can always be generous. Always be a blessing. That's why God wants you to be successful in your business. Not so you can travel the world. Not so you can live for self all the time. But so that you can be blessed to bless others. Because what did Jesus say? It is more blessed to what? Give than to receive. Giving to God and his work is, I'm getting ahead here. Verse 18, at the moment, I have all I need. He's in prison. Isn't that amazing? He's in prison. What do we say? Get me a good attorney. Give me Johnny Cochran. Right? He says, I have all I need and more. Why? Because he had Christ. I am generously supplied with the gifts you sent me with Epaphroditus. That was the guy from his church, their church. They are a sweet-smelling sacrifice that is acceptable and pleasing to God. Hear that, guys? This is why I pray when we worship, you know, Holy Spirit, you, sorry for the saying, welcome here, that we're saying when we give, we see that as worship too. It's not, oh, great, offering, I got to go to the bathroom. But we go, this is a time where I get to honor the Lord with my wealth, because Jesus said, where my treasure is, there my heart. And I love you so much, I'm giving my treasure to you. Remember, isn't that what I say? I bring my gifts to him, pa-rum-pa-pum-pum. Some of you go, I bring my change to him, pa-rum-pa-pum, lint and pocket lint, right? I mean, I bring my best for him. I didn't have much, but I give everything I have. Offering time should be one of the most powerful times of worship. Because it's what tells where you are spiritually. Because Jesus says, coming out, Jesus is watching what you give. And he is seeing where your treasure is. Oh, your treasure is very small in the giving. So guess what? I mean very little to you. Giving to God and his work is a sweet-smelling sacrifice to him. It pleases him. It honors him. But if we don't trust in God's word, if you don't believe what God is saying through me today, and you don't give to him and his work, then guess what? It can become stinky. This church worship time can become smelly to God. It can be the smell of selfishness, the smell of greed. It can become the stench of robbery. I want to ask you this right now. How many of you have ever been robbed? Raise your hand. How many of you have ever been robbed? Did anyone like being robbed? Did anyone say that was awesome? Have you ever been mugged? I was mugged in New York. That's really not fun. But hear this. What I'm going to read to you right now, God says that when we don't give to him, it's like being mugged. That word robbery here is like being assaulted. Does anyone want to assault God? Does anyone want to offend God, hurt God? Here's what God says to the prophet Malachi, Malachi 3:8. Will a man rob God? Hear that for the fresh for once. I know you've already heard this before, but just hear it. in the sense of how you felt when you were robbed. Will a man rob God? Yet you have robbed me. But you say, in what way have we robbed you? God's answer is, in tithes and offerings. Notice tithes and offerings. Verse 9, you are cursed. What happens to someone who robs? What happens to them? They go to jail. They get imprisoned. They get in trouble if they get caught. They are cursed. Nobody likes a robber, right? They get shot sometimes. You are cursed with a curse, for you have robbed me, even this whole nation. Isn't that true about our nation? Look, $19 trillion in debt and growing every second. Verse 10, here's the answer. Bring all the tithes into the storehouse, or today would be what? The church. That there may be food, or you could say provision, in my house. It's hard for the church to be a blessing when it's not blessed. Amen? I told you the stats, remember? That the average giving of the church in America, total giving, they say is about $3 billion a year. And most of that is Joel Osteen. Okay, but a little joke there. He's worth $47 million. But hear this. If everyone tithed, the church would have $73 billion every year. What could godly churches and godly ministries do with an extra $70 billion? Amen? We spend right now more money on our interest payments for our building than we do, as all the church in America, than we do in our total missions giving. How many know God sees that? And I hope you get angry with that just as much as I do. Wouldn't it be neat if we had this building paid off and we could give all the money, the $5,000 a month we're giving this building, to give that to missions? Wouldn't that be neat? Amen? You guys are getting awful quiet on me. Verse 19. How many have this verse? Let me read it first and ask you this afterwards. And my God shall supply all your needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. How many have that underlined? How many know that verse? Anyone? Raise your hand. Three people. Okay. But then most of you have heard it, right? And you claim that? Yes. My God shall supply all my needs. Yes. Now hear this. Here's where we're going to end this good. Who are the people that God promises to provide for, especially in these hard times? Is it just any Joe Blow? Remember what I said to you? A lot of his promises have conditions of obedience, do they not? And here it is. Those who trust God by giving to him and his work. Those who truly believe his word that they can what? Never outgive God. I can't tell you how many people, and I'm one of them, who tithe their way out of debt. That makes no sense, does it? But neither does walking on water. Amen? They tithe their way out of debt. I've told you before, and I'll say it again. Try it. The Bible says, test me, as we're going to read right now. If you give checks, I don't want cash, because I can't believe you guys if you do that. But you write a check, and you tithe, and you say, that's not 3% called a tithe. You tithe 10% of your gross income, and you do it for 6 months. And if you say, I am just as bad as I was 6 months ago, then I will gladly give you all your money back. Because guess what I know? If you do it out of love for God and obedience to his word, you will what? Be blessed. Amen. And you can say, oh, you're just saying that selfishly. I'm saying it selfishly for you, that you receive a blessing and reward. And God can be my judge. I'm saying it because I want you to be blessed. Amen? Because as you trust him, you will be blessed. Here it is, Malachi 3:10. Bring all the tithes into the storehouse, the church. That there may be food in my house or provision. Hear this, test me or try me now in this. It's the only place in the whole Bible, 66 books, God says, test me, try me. See if this is true, says the Lord of hosts. If I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out for you such blessing that there will not be room enough to receive it. How many know that used to be America? That used to be America. 100 years ago, that was America. Verse 11, and I'll rebuke the devourer for your sakes so that he will not destroy. Hear this, I'll rebuke the devourer. How many would like the devourer rebuked from your house and from this land? I rebuke the devourer from your sake, so he will not, notice it's like almost like a spirit, he will not destroy the fruit of your ground, nor shall the vine fail to bear fruit for you in the field, says the Lord of hosts. And again, here it is, I read it already, verse 12, and all the nations will call, hear this, New Living Translation, America blessed again. How many like to see that in their lifetime? America not be the curse of the world, but to see it blessed. And that's because why? The favor of God is on America if we honor him with our wealth. All the nations will call it blessed, for you will be a delightful land, says the Lord of hosts. I'll tell you can call me whatever, I'm foolish enough to want to believe this land can become delightful again. I really believe, because I believe, why am I here if it's just to hang on and by my fingernails and die? Because if I say that, Lord, if me preaching revival is not true, then take me home right now. I mean that with all my heart. But I believe God has me here and has you here for such a time as this to see. How many are excited to see Ted Cruz, number two in the presidential run? That's a miracle. Remember 5 years ago we're saying, is there any godly men out there? Is there anyone? And now we got anyone but what we got right now and who's wanting to replace him. How many know? I'm happy with it. I even take Donald Trump with the weird hair. But I'd really rather have Ted Cruz. Amen. You know, but I'm so amazed. The only guy could do that. Because we always go, oh, dude, I was like,
well, you know, just he won't be able to get the moderates. There's no way he can do it. I mean, God can't do it anymore. He used to do miracles, but not anymore.
And God's like, what? I can do it. How many want to believe God to do it again? Amen. Then let's do what he asks. Amen. Don't say, God, move, and I'm not moving, but you move. God says, we'll move. You do what I ask, and then I'll do what I promise to do. But it's not. It's going to be both of us together, not one or the other. I want to read a story to you, and I'm almost done. I only get to preach every once in a while, and I get to make you happy, so that's why I go long in these. So sorry, Beverly. Beverly says, let's speed this up. Long today, but anyways. I try to move around, keep you, you know. But anyway, here's a story. Anyone heard of Kerr jars? Kerr jars? Canning jars? Is a few of those of you young kids go, what's a jar? A Kerr jar was a canning jar for jellies and preserves and all that, and it had the weird funky lid, and it had the lid on the lid, and you screw it on, and people drink out of them now. But anyway, Kerr jars. It's still around, but Kerr jars. Hear this. He was converted under the ministry of D.L. Moody at the age of 14, and joined the Presbyterian Church at Philadelphia in 1902. Mr. Kerr read the book entitled Judah's Scepter and Joseph's Birthright by Bishop Allen. In his book, Bishop Allen referred to the vow Jacob made in Genesis 28:22. Now hear this, I want to say this real quick, this is free. Isn't it amazing how we love a lot of the promises of the Old Testament? But when it comes to tithing, we go,
excuse me, it's not the New Testament.
Yes, it is. It is the New Testament.
You go, well, okay, where is it?
Matthew 23:23. Remember Jesus said, you tithe in your mint and everything? But he says, of course you should tithe, but don't forget justice, mercy, and love. But isn't it funny, in the old days, 100 years ago, they didn't have a problem separating Old Testament, New Testament. They still believe if giving, and here's what I say, we're not under the law to give, amen? But if 10% was a good template in the Old Testament, how many know it should be a really great template in the better covenant, the new covenant? Amen? You don't say, God, thanks a lot. I'm going to give you half of what I used to. You give more to a better covenant, right? So here it is. Genesis 28:22. He made the vow where we find the following words. He said this, that thou shalt give me, I will surely give a tenth unto thee. So he's saying, anything you bless me with, I'm going to give a tithe to you. I'm going to give 10% to you. With some doubts, he's a brand new Christian, but with sincere desire to test, remember it says, try me on this, it said in Malachi 3, if the Bible is true, to prove without a shadow of a doubt that there is a personal God and that his promises are from everlasting to everlasting, that means they're still the same today, and that they are intended for people of this day, Mr. Kerr, on June 1st, 1902, made a special covenant to set aside 10% of his income for the work of the Lord. At the time, now hear this, is for those of you who say, I'm not rich enough to tithe yet. Here it is. At the time he made this, he had a mortgage on his little home, owed many obligations, and was burdened with cares and worries, especially of financial nature. Anyone relate to that? Yeah. Okay, here it is. Here's his answer, though. He says, however, he was determined to prove God, to test God, as Jacob did. And the verses he gives a bunch. I can give them to you later. It's Proverbs. Do you want the verses or I better go? Malachi basically reads, the one is Malachi 3, 7 through 18, what I just read to you. Mr. Kerr often remarked that the modern-day skeptics, if they wanted proof that there is a God, that the Bible is his holy word, that all its promises are true, all that is necessary to prove this is to tithe for 1 year. And God will prove to them without a doubt that he is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. Hebrews 13:8. Within 3 months of tithing, after Mr. Kerr obeyed God in this, he had unexpected, unforeseen blessings that came to him, so much so that it seemed to him that God had thus opened up the floodgates of heaven, and his eyes beheld his love and his faithfulness in a new way, and his promises became more real to him, especially in the regard to tithing or giving of one-tenth of his wealth. Now hear this. The same year, Mr. Kerr, with a very small capital, but with strong faith in God's tithing promises, contained in Malachi 3, 10 through 12, organized the firm known as Kerr Glass Manufacturing Company, which eventually became one of the largest firms selling fruit jars in the United States. How many would like to have that witness? That how did you get the biggest God? How many people listen to people like that, right? We have people, I did it myself. I did it my way. No, God did it. Here it is. One of the largest firms selling fruit jars in the United States. The jars were manufactured, hear this, in San Francisco. At the time when he started this, the San Francisco earthquake broke out in 1906. His firm was manufacturing his fruit jars there. Mr. Kerr had put practically every cent he owned into the business there. At the time when things were going well, the earthquake came. His friends came to him and said, Mr. Kerr, you are a ruined man. He replied, wouldn't you love to say this? I don't believe it. I know God will not go back on his promises found in Malachi. He wired to San Francisco. He wasn't in San Francisco at the time. And received the following reply. Your factory is in the heart of the fire and undoubtedly is destroyed. The heat is so intense which is unable to find out anything for some days. He was unable to find it. Hear this. Glass, he had propane because they had to heat the glass. He had propane tanks. It was the most vulnerable building in the center of town because it had more gas and had glass can light on fire too. It was just a hotbed to be destroyed. But they said, it's so hot, we can't go in there for days. What a testing this was of his belief in Malachi 3. But his faith in the Lord never wavered. Why did it never waver? Because he obeyed God, amen? If you're not obeying God, you're giving 2%, calling a tithe, how many know your faith's going to probably waver? But he said he believed Malachi 3:11, I will rebuke the devourer for your sakes, and he shall not destroy the fruit of your ground. He stood on the promise, unmoved, about a week after the earthquake. How many know God will test our faith sometimes, won't he? A week after the earthquake, the fire, a second telegram arrived saying to him, everything from a mile and a half on all sides of the factory are burned to the ground. And hear this. Well, let me read this. But your factory was miraculously saved. It's almost like there's a God, isn't it? They said the fires touched his fence and scorched the fence, but didn't go past the fence of his property. How would you like to have that? Every house burned down your neighborhood. You're like, you're sitting there out there watering your lawn. Hey, how's it going? What is going on? Tithing. I like that. And that's what made people, that's why we still know Kerr jars today, because of God. I don't know if they're still tithing. But hear this, you know, and I'm told, I couldn't find it, but I'm told his wife, when he died, his wife was the one who finally said, you know what? He gave a lot. But his wife said, you know what? I only need to live on this much. And she ended up giving more than 90% to ministry. How many would like to be able to do that? That's what she did. Wow. Wow. So what's the answer? The answer is let's trust God with the tithe. And we too will be blessed just like Mr. Kerr. Because God, as he said, is what? The same yesterday, today, and forevermore. And he's what? No respecter of persons. He does not love Mr. Kerr more than he loves you. But he loved Mr. Kerr because Mr. Kerr honored him with his wealth. Amen? I want you to see, do not pray for revival until you're obeying the simple things that God has asked. Right? Obey this and trust me. The church will be blessed and you will be more blessed. Because why? It is more blessed to give than to receive. Paul says, thanks guys, but here's the real kicker. The reward is really yours because you gave to the work of the Lord. Amen? And hear this. Look at me in the eyes. You either believe that or you don't. But don't cry to your friends and me when America stays the same. But if you want America to change, then we have to go back to what the great men and women of old did. And they believe that when God says to honor him with his wealth, that's what he meant. And not wish to do it. You need to just step out and do it. Because guess what? There's never going to be a good time to tithe. Amen? There's always going to be something you need to fix. But if you see it like a mortgage payment, it's just, I can't touch it, then guess what? You'll see, like Mr. Kerr, miracles where you just go, oh my goodness, I don't want to point anyone out, but I know someone said, I tithe, and all of a sudden I got a check out of the mail I didn't even know I had. I love those stories, don't you? I told you my story. I'll end with this, but I told you my story. My wife's doing the checkbook, and she does the checkbook. She balances it, I think, every three years. But anyways, you know, but my wife does it at least not so often, and all of a sudden, she's $1,400 ahead. And I'm like, what did you do? I mean, I liked it was ahead, but I'm like, it must be wrong. And she calls the bank, long story short. Bank says, no, it's our mess up. We must have taken someone else's money and put it in your account. Don't you love banks? And they didn't take it. They said, well, if someone complains, we'll take it out, but right now we'll leave it. So here you go. Here's $1,400. Praise the Lord. I love God's accounting. I don't want to be the person that he had to borrow $1,400 from, but I mean, that is pretty cool. Amen? And that's what God does. And I mean, there's stuff. Sometimes when we're so short, I go, how do we survive? I literally go to our bookkeeper. Are you sure you got the math right? Because it doesn't make sense. Now somebody says, oh, you're doing fine, so I won't give. No! But isn't it cool how God does it? And I tell you, I want you to enjoy the joy like Mr. Kerr. Because guess what? God loves a cheerful giver. And why are you cheerful? Because you know, I can't give out God. I can't outgive God. Woo! I don't want you going, here you go, you stinking tithe. You give to the Lord in love. Here it is. And my God shall supply all your needs to those who what? Give. According to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. See the condition on that verse? And know if you meet it, you can, just like Mr. Kerr, know it's going to be all right. How many want to know that in these times? God's got my back. Well, honor God and he'll honor you. The worship team's going to play a song. We're going to pass out the elements and we're going to have communion together. And let's celebrate the greatest gift. Amen? That I love this. Romans 8:32 says that he who did not spare his own son, Jesus, God didn't spare Jesus, but delivered him up for us all. How will he not also with him freely give us all things? How many are glad that God gave his son for you? That God showed you the greatest sacrifice of giving is giving his son for what? Ungrateful people like us. Because a lot of us at times, right? When we were yet sinners and we could care less, Christ died for us. So how much more should we, that we know it, say, God, I want to give everything to you because I love you. Amen. I want to encourage you. You can turn the lights down. I want to encourage you that as the song's playing, prepare your heart for communion. We have open communion here, but we just ask you that if there's any unconfessed sins, confess it to God, because the Bible says that if you don't do it, if you take communion lightly, it says many are weak and sick in Hebrews or 1 Corinthians 11, and it says many are weak and sick and even sleep. And that means judgment. So we want you to be right with God. Amen. So just take this time as the song's playing to get right with the Lord if there's any areas in your life that you need to confess.